I think since we have only 90 minutes today, we should welcome everyone to the vaccine, our webinar on vaccine confidence in the time of COVID. Thank you all for taking the time to join with us today. We have a pretty dynamic and fast moving 90 minutes. I'll talk for a little bit about what we know from the various surveys around the world. This is Heidi Larson here, director of the Vaccine Confidence Project, and to give you a glimpse of what we're learning on what people are thinking and anticipating around a potential COVID vaccine. Then Beata Kampmann will be giving us a bit of a landscaping of the state of things with the development of a vaccine for COVID, to protect against COVID. Then we'll move into a session which will give some regional perspectives on the COVID response and implications for a COVID vaccine. And then finally, we'll come around to, given all these different, the state of things, the potential challenges and opportunities, an action initiative that we'll be launching called Convince, and you'll hear from Nancy Lee and Scott Rodson about it. I'll start by giving you a glimpse of, let me share my screen here. Is that visible for everyone?
Yes. Can
everyone see? Yes, okay, great. One thing we've learned in all of our surveying on vaccine confidence, and this, what I'll share with you now is just also what we've learned from some of our colleagues and collaborators around the world. One of the things we've seen is how volatile public sentiment is around potential COVID vaccine. Not unlike vaccine sentiments in general, they've become much more volatile over the last, particularly the last decade. Used to be far more stable in certainly two decades ago and before. In France, for instance, in March, 26% of the national representative sample said that they would not accept a vaccine if it became available. Whereas in China, 87% said they would take a vaccine. I should add that the between the 26% in France that would not use it, 60% said they would take it. And there was a group of uncertainty in the middle, which is certainly understandable, particularly in March. In the US, in April and May, it was 72% said they would get a COVID vaccine and 27% said they would not. But that's more recently, nearly half of the population said they would not take the vaccine. We all know from experience in vaccine acceptance research that surveys on intended acceptance is, you can get an indicative sense, but it really, the reality is when the vaccine is there and offered and people's behaviors may change, certainly in this highly uncertain context. This is in the UK, and just to give you an example of a changing sentiment over time, in mid-March, 7% of the UK population said they would not take a vaccine if it became available. 2 weeks later, that dropped to only 5% refusing. And why was that? That was because that was the peak of the fatality rates, COVID-related fatality, mortality rates that we had seen. So people were feeling more willing to take a vaccine. And then as the background number of COVID-related deaths started to decline, the willingness to take a vaccine also started to decline. The disagrees started to go up. So that's something we have to keep in mind. People are very, they do weigh the risks against the threats. Scott Radson's collaboration with Emerson Poling, Scott at City University of New York, who will be speaking later and showing and picking up on this slide again, just to see the spectrum of different willingness for a vaccine. Again, this was in June. And as I mentioned, France is 60%, but that's quite a spectrum. I do want to add that this only picks up two countries in Africa, Nigeria and South Africa, and we are working on getting more nuanced understanding of what's happening in Africa. Yodi Alakija will be speaking about Nigeria and the Africa perspective. But at least I think by keeping our finger on the pulse and talking with people, listening to what their sentiments are, will be important as we plan out our preparedness moving forward. The other aspect of willingness and confidence that we've seen is, it's one thing to say whether people would take it or not, and then to understand, well, what do they care about? Safety is clearly one of the most sensitive issues and concerns, but importance is also a concern. It doesn't matter. If I don't feel the threat, maybe I don't need it. I'm not even thinking about safety if I don't even need a vaccine. And then efficacy, will it work? We see with the flu vaccine every year, the rates of efficacy change. And that's certainly going to be one of the big questions that the public will be asking and we should have in our preparedness plans. Just a last slide, since we don't have the detailed data yet, although we are working closely with Africa CDC and the Africa Union to get a more representative sense of public sentiment around a potential vaccine. This is from our global research on vaccine confidence more broadly, and I just wanted to share this as kind of the background landscape for introducing a COVID vaccine in Africa. While there's generally higher confidence in the importance of vaccines more broadly, and that's pretty true globally, when it comes to safety, that confidence metric changes significantly. And in Africa, even though there's more positive sense of importance of vaccine, we do see some very low numbers in different countries, as low as 33% confidence in safety in Togo, 45% in Mauritius, 56% in Burkina Faso. I mean, we do have a low end. There is higher end, but just we can also keep in context, as in our preparedness, what is the background. So thanks. I just wanted to kick off with a bit of a background. We're thrilled to have everyone here. Thank you again for joining us. And I'll turn over to Beata Kampmann to tell us a bit more about the state of the vaccine landscape from a development perspective.
Yeah, thank you very much, Heidi. And thanks for the Vaccine Confidence Project for inviting the Vaccine Center to contribute to this session. What I will show you, or hope I've brought to the table, is really a little bit of background of where the vaccine pipelines are, because we need to understand the context of the developments in the field, I think, to make good plans for where the major obstacles to implementation might lie later on. So I give you a brief overview, and I will touch on some of the issues around how safety might or might not be monitored during these trials. So, oops, let's see if I can get my slides to move forward. Here we go. Just to put the global data on the map here from our vaccine tracker at the London School, we've got 14 million cases, we've got over 500,000 people who've died of COVID, and we've got a global pandemic. And the death rate that we've seen from COVID are totally different from the death rates that we've seen of other infectious diseases who have also exercised the global community significantly over the last decade. There is no question in anyone's mind that we need a vaccine to come out of this scenario. Now, there isn't time here to talk about immunology, but I just wanted to put one slide up here to remind everybody about the principles of vaccination, that they expose our immune system to antigens from a very specific pathogen, and that this causes an immune response that includes the production of antibodies, but also cellular immune responses. And these are precisely the kinds of responses that we are currently getting information about from some of the leading vaccine candidates. So what are the vaccines looking at? They're looking at inducing immune responses against certain key antigens, in particular the spike protein, which are these spiky bits here. Everybody now has the figure of the COVID virus ingrained. It comes up in every single television performance about it. And there's also the nuclear capsid and the receptor binding protein. So there are several antigenic targets, and they matter for the kind of vaccines that are being currently developed. There's a whole plethora out of there of vaccines, and you know the numbers vary. Is it 180? Is it 220? People often don't make a distinction between the phases of where the vaccines are in. And our vaccine tracker here that shows the pipeline shows at the moment we in fact have 218 candidates, of which 189 are in preclinical development. And I will not talk about those, you'll be pleased to hear. And some of the ones who are in phase 1, 2, 3, which are the ones that are really starting to be of greater interest and where the context is really important, because the platforms on which of these vaccines are developed are quite different between very new technologies, the so-called plug and play, which look very promising, but no vaccine like that has been licensed ever. The non-replicating viral vectors, of which several have now reached phase 2 already, and the old, more old-fashioned types of vaccines, which are inactivated or life attenuated or protein subunit vaccines. And on our tracker, you can see a summary of where these different candidates are in the various pipelines. And for the purpose of the short presentation today, I'm going to focus on this spectrum here. What we want to really sort of reflect upon is the process in which these vaccines are evaluated, because as Heidi already alluded to, the whole question of safety is one that actually exercises people's minds the most, I think. Sometimes I feel safety exercises the mind a lot more than efficacy, but we actually need both in order to combat this pandemic. So you probably all know that there's a preclinical and a clinical phase to vaccine evaluation all along. The preclinical very much relates to animal experiments and laboratory side of things. And once there is a candidate that looks promising, it can go into safety trials, which are the first in human trials. They're usually done in healthy adult volunteers who have really been very screened very, very carefully. And they happen in fairly small groups of people. So the safety data we can get from those are encouraging, but they're not definitive. And if any vaccine fails in the phase 1 safety trials, it for sure won't go any further. In phase 2, then, the vaccine is given to hundreds of people and they're split into groups or might have an increased risk. And that further tests the vaccine safety and also the ability to get the kind of immune response that we think is important. And this is very tricky for COVID because it was probably a mixture of antibody and cellular immune response, but how much and of what quality and how it might last for, none of us know at this place. And ultimately, the efficacy trials in phase 3 will have to show whether the vaccine does what it is supposed to do, which means prevent the disease in the people who've been vaccinated, and that there's a comparison of prevention of disease in those vaccinated versus those people not vaccinated, and that gives you an estimate of the vaccine's efficacy at that point in time. It won't tell you about long-term efficacy, but that's usually the portfolio of data that needs to be submitted to regulatory authorities to then give approval for a vaccine to be used. And during a pandemic, there might be emergency use, and we've seen this, for example, with the Ebola vaccine. Now, we are now in a situation where these phases are very much combined, and we're developing COVID vaccines at pandemic speed. And there's a really nice paper from the CEPI group, which has also summarized this where the phases that we're currently using are somewhat overlapping, and you will see all of a sudden trials being published that says phase 1/2 or phase 2/3. So everything is kind of squashed together a little bit. And then some additional considerations obviously are being voiced with regards to manufacturing capabilities and large scale equity as well. And the phase 1 reports that we've seen in the recent literature from the last 2 months relate primarily to the vectored vaccines, but also to RNA vaccines. And the interested folks will no doubt have read these papers already. And what I think is really interesting also in the context of the discussion we're having today is that on Friday, for example, there was already reporting about the huge excitement about the data from, example, the Oxford vaccine that hadn't even been published or even brought forward by the Oxford team. And they appeared on Monday. And sure enough, they look promising. But I found it was really telling that we already have media reporting on trial data that not even the investigators have released. And I think we need to be very, very mindful about this space. And we as scientists, we already get rung up by journalists who comment on data that are not even in the public domain. So I think this is a cause for concern for the community in this audience. So as we know, not every vaccine candidate makes it, and here are the so-called valleys of death, first of all, between discovery and the preclinical and phase 1, but then also between the trials that might have shown good results and the licensure to routine use and scale up. And in our mind, there's actually a third valley, which means we also need to talk about availability and uptake, because you can have the best vaccine in the world. If nobody wants to take it, then we have a problem. And Heidi has already alluded to some obstacles that might be existing from the past and also around COVID. Although we don't necessarily need 100% of people be vaccinated against COVID to stop the transmission of this disease. So whilst we wait for the vaccines to come through, we're also starting to pay attention to the questions of how do we decide who should be vaccinated, because it is quite unlikely that there's going to be enough vaccine for the entire world, and also unlikely that it will only be one particular type of vaccine. So we need to consider severity of the disease. Are we preventing severe disease, or are we preventing transmission? This has got huge implications for individual decision-making, but also for transmission dynamics in societies, and both of those matter for this pandemic. Are we looking at vaccines that are going to get given to risk groups, such as healthcare workers or the elderly? What is the effectiveness of the vaccine once it's actually launched, its acceptability, its costs, and weighing up the gains for the individual versus the gains for the community? So we know vaccines benefit not only the individual, and there is a huge secondary knock-on effect of vaccination beyond, for also education, the economy, and national and global security. And I think the COVID pandemic has really shown us in which wide a field an infectious disease plays there, and potentially a vaccine will impact on all of those circles. So there is a lot of talk about equity of access, and the WHO, Gavi, and CEPI are leading an initiative which is called Ensuring Global Equitable Access, because it is already obvious that countries who have significantly contributed to the funding of the vaccine research will also want to have a first pick at the crop. That might leave low and middle income countries as second best. And what we need to make sure is that there is some agreement in place that the vaccines are available. And so this is called the Access to COVID Tools Accelerator Initiative. And as I've said, CEPI is playing a significant role in this with the COVAX initiative, in which many players are contributing to think about advanced market agreements and how we can commit countries to funding of access to COVID vaccines beyond their own borders. So this is an important piece of work, which I call how to remitigate these Ferrari trial safety concerns and how we make sure that safety remains a priority. And on the 10th of July, the WHO published a report of about 12 pages in the usual epidemiological reports, which address these various issues. What vaccines are there? how is the pharmacovigilant preparedness for them? What sort of benefit risk assessments do we need to think about? How do we leverage existing safety networks within the frameworks that are already established in partner countries to be prepared for COVID vaccine launch? And also acceptance and uptake really features in that. And I would really encourage people to read this document, because there are now various working groups that are trying to populate this conceptual framework with the necessary detail. And what we also must not forget is there's a fair amount of fallout, which I call COVID collateral, because immunization efforts worldwide have already suffered from the fact that immunization programs are not working as effectively as they normally do. And there are many thousands of children already out there who are not currently receiving licensed safe vaccines. And with that, I just hand back to Heidi. And if you want to follow us further in the Vaccine Center to have a look at the pipelines, how they evolve, please get in touch. And we're pleased to also get engaged, obviously, in further discussions. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Beata. That was a really helpful overview. Also reiterating some of the concerns and opportunities. We have some huge opportunities that we need to harness. I'm thrilled to have today some insights and experts from different regional perspectives to think about the implications of the COVID response in affecting the trust and willingness of publics to anticipate a COVID vaccine. We have Yodi Alakija, the former Chief Humanitarian Coordinator in Nigeria. I won't read major bios here, just to save time, but we've shared them on the screen. Lisa Lin, Assistant Professor with our Vaccine Confidence Project, particularly working on social science and public health preparedness in emergencies, but has done extensive research in the Asia region and also in the US, and herself is from Taiwan. Clarissa Simas will be speaking about Latin America. Clarissa is from Brazil and will reflect on Brazil, but the region more broadly. We thought to bring the reality from the ground was really important to consider then as we move forward. So I'll start with Clarissa to tell us, give some comments on the overview of the Latin America COVID response. I mean, clearly different countries have handled things differently, but let's hear from Clarissa.
Hi, everyone. Heidi, thank you so much for the invitation to speak at this webinar. So as Heidi mentioned, I'm going to start giving a brief overview of different responses to COVID-19, and then I'll jump to three key messages of what I think we should look for in terms of COVID vaccine acceptance. So the first thing is that there were lots of variations in responses in Latin America. So some countries such as Uruguay and Peru had very strict measures early in the pandemic. In fact, Peru has had even longer lockdowns than some European countries. Whereas other countries, such as Brazil, my home country, and Mexico, have not taken coronavirus measures very seriously at a federal level. But even though there were differences in responses, the outcomes overall have not been great. So many of the measures which have proved successful in containing this pandemic in high-income nations were far less successful in Latin American countries. And here for this talk, I want to highlight two factors that are contributing to that. The first one is the long-sustained social and economic inequalities, which makes structurally difficult for people to comply with those measures. So this is the first factor. And the second is a pervasive mistrust in government that is very common in the region. And when I say pervasive mistrust, I'd like to make the point that Latin American countries, they have very different histories of how populations have interacted with healthcare systems, with the state. And the consequences of those interactions can make people more or less likely to trust and to follow government orders. So I think especially when the orders are so restrictive, such as stay home for months so we can contain this pandemic. And on top of the mistrust, as I mentioned, there are economic issues such as the prevalence of an informal labor market. And at times, lack of home appliances such as refrigerators meant that people needed to leave their homes for work and food daily. So the idea of self-isolating and quarantining wasn't that easy to comply. In Peru, for example, food markets were a big hub for coronavirus contamination. So to illustrate this, in Brazil, if you go to social media, it's very common to find a user-generated motto circulating that says, stay home if you can. So this refers to the fact that working from home is a privilege, which is not held by many who don't have job security and that need to go out to ensure income. So having all that in mind, I wanted to share three key points about building trust for a COVID vaccine in the region. So the first point, and now I'm going to draw from our research as the Vaccine Confidence Project, is that there has been an overall drop in vaccine confidence in Latin America in the past 5 years. So for the past 5 years, we've been running global surveys on vaccine confidence. We have covered most of Latin America and have also run in-depth qualitative studies in the region, such as focus groups and in-depth interviews. And we have data coming out soon showing those significant drops. And this is concerning, particularly when they happen in countries that have been historically confident. And I even dare to say that the whole region has been historically confident. So it is a big lesson in terms of there is no bulletproof area. There is no not monitoring vaccine confidence. We can't trust that if a place or if a country is confident, that's going to remain the same throughout the years or the decades. So we do believe that there is an absolute need to continue on monitoring. The data that we have from the past 5 years, it is all pre-COVID, but to us, it is highly likely that those pockets of vaccine hesitancy will play a role in current situation, especially given that new vaccines and one that is being produced at a record time are likely to bring feelings of uncertainty, doubts about safety and efficacy of vaccines. So we believe that that will add to the already waning confidence in the region. A second point is that all those factors that I've mentioned previously, social, political, and economic realities that had a role in other measures, they will also play a part in how the COVID vaccine is accepted and how confidence is built. So we also know from our previous research in Latin America and in other lower income settings that long legacies of systematic neglect and sometimes even abuse by government and health services added to weaker health system configurations, they do negatively impact vaccine confidence. So exactly what played a part in making it difficult to follow measures can come into play here to create some hesitancy around the vaccine as well. And because they are so context specific, as I said, the countries are so different among each other, we are going to see very likely different levels of vaccine confidence and acceptance in different nations. And the third point, and to me, it's certainly the one that has the most uncertainty, but definitely worth bringing, is that a COVID vaccine could become highly politicized, not only by vaccination groups in the region, but also by federal governments. So considering how many governments in Latin America have responded to measures such as using masks and social distancing and have not given support to those measures, I don't think we can guarantee that there will be a support from federal government to this vaccine. I really don't know what's gonna happen. Maybe there is, maybe there isn't, but it's not uncommon to see vaccine debates being co-opted by political reason, particularly when you have more populist leaders. So this adds another layer of concern to building confidence in a future vaccine. So since this is a very volatile topic, I think it's definitely an area of concern and that we should pay attention to. So with that, I hand back to Heidi. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Clarissa. All relevant for, I think, a number of countries, but particularly Latin America. And I have to say, historically, we've always looked to Latin America as being the poster child of positive confidence in the world. So it's really concerning to see erosion at the edges and the politicization of vaccination, which we're seeing in a number of settings. but there are opportunities there to build on the trust we have. But trust is a theme throughout our session today. And now I'll turn to Lisa Lin, who will talk about, I'm going to put the question out, based on your experience across Asia, as well as research in the US, quite different ends of the spectrum in terms of the COVID response, if you could give your perspectives on that and the implications for introducing vaccines. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Heidi. Thank you very much for the invitation to this very important topic. So I will start with have a quick overview of Asian Southeast Asian responses, and then talk about the research that I've done and how that influenced how the response in the U.S. and then how the implications of the vaccine preparedness. So between January and March 2020, many East Asian and Southeast Asian countries, including like mainland China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, South Korea, Vietnam, and Singapore suffered from the so-called first wave of COVID-19. Most of these countries experienced SARS in 2003, and then South Korea in particular also experienced MERS outbreak in 2015. The past experiences fundamentally shape how these countries and regions decided to like respond to COVID. East Asian and Southeast Asian countries usually take an aggressive SARS-like response, aided by their universal healthcare systems, and then with a clear goal to eliminate the disease the way they did with SARS and MERS. So despite distinctive differences in political structures, the Asian responses share similar features. First, it's a rapid containment effort supported by strong public consensus and support. So the general public in these areas demonstrate high levels of awareness and cooperation with epidemic prevention measures. Some might see that, especially in the early days, to be restrictive, and even some call them to be draconian, as in like lockdowns, face covering, and then cancellations of like public events, for example. But then the public support in this area were very strong early on. And then even without being prompt, most people wore masks and avoided crowded places before the government even put policies in place. Second, there I think it's highlighted by the strong leadership from the government and strict enforcement. Unlike some of the European or US European countries and the U.S., a lot of these measures are mandatory instead of advisory. So, for example, face covering, quarantine, which are strictly enforced, and then tracking and tracing. Further, testing and treatment costs for COVID-19 in these areas are mostly covered by the government, which reduces the financial burden of the public and encourages access to care. That is a major factor for rapid and effective outbreak control in this region. It is benefited by the universal healthcare system that share among this region. That helps level the playing field for subcommunities, especially to reduce disparities among populations. And I think one key feature that is quite unlike the rest of the globe is the use of big data. So I think, some of the, maybe you've seen in the report and the papers, like for example, regions like mainland China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and then South Korea, like in Singapore, they all have their own version of use of big data. And then taking advantage of the AI and then also the universal healthcare system, which means like the universal medical data they have, and then in aiding the response. So by mid-March, the first wave of the epidemic was largely brought under control. And then now they are dealing with like second waves that are coming, for example, like travelers coming back from other part of the world, and then so that, but then most of the I would say that, for example, in where I was from, Taiwan, I think people have been relatively living their normal life. They were able to manage it without lockdown. South Korea as well, they were managed to pretty much carry on with normal social and economic activities. And I think that countries like mainland China, after the lockdown, I think ended in April, they have periodic regional second outbreak, but then most of the people that in the greater part of the country has been carry on with normal life. School has opened, people back in office, for example. However, I think before I move on to the US response, I would like to highlight that rapid containment and strong leadership, as well as strict enforcement, are key to the success of emergency responses. However, these are not limited to the Asian context. New Zealand is a great example of that. So the US so far has taken a different path. So governments have given ambiguous and often conflicting messaging as their priority, often seem to be to stabilizing the economy and at best flattening the curve. And therefore, I think since the beginning, full elimination of disease did not seem to be a consideration. I think this is a very similar approach that we will see that back in the 2009-2010 H1N1 pandemic. That was a similar approach compared to COVID-19 right now. So decision makers are somewhat slow in response. Restrictive measures such as strict quarantines, cancellations of events, and etc. Were considered even politicized as an invasion of individual rights and freedom. Unlike Southeast Asian countries, which largely managed to contain the outbreak to one geographical region, US faced multiple hotspots within their borders. To date, the US has mostly relied on local governors to navigate the response with limited national coordination in terms of data sharing, implementing containment or reopening strategies, and then contact tracing and quarantine. So I think I would like to get into the what are the implications for vaccine preparedness? To eradicate COVID-19 and to resume normal social and economic activities, countries will have to vaccinate an unprecedentedly high percentage of their population in order to achieve vaccine level herd immunity. Some data suggested that we need at least 60 to 70% of population to be vaccinated for COVID-19 vaccines to reach that level. However, if we look at the H1N1 pandemic, in the US, we had less than 30% of the US population received the vaccine. So, which is a great concern. And I would like to highlight two, in addition to what Clarissa and other experts has presented, I would like to highlighted two features that we should address. One is COVID-19 denialism, which will likely be a barrier to a potential COVID-19 vaccine rollout. And then the second would be communication inequalities, which means how people access, interpret, and use risk information would be greatly associated with their social demographic factors. So, COVID-19 denialism. This is a psychological defense of denial, which states that the problem doesn't exist and it was observed during the Ebola outbreak and has been widely shared in the US during this this current pandemic, even by top government officials. It has been a challenge to throughout the response and it's likely to pose a great threat to a smooth COVID-19 vaccine rollout. COVID-19 denial has taken a cultural narrative that has been categorized by many as a form of bravery, or even that they were defending American democracy, American freedom, and individual liberty. I think experiences from previous epidemics, such as H1N1, highlighted a significant association between risk perception about the disease threat and the vaccine uptake. And therefore, COVID-19 denialism is going to pose a threat on how we convince people that it is necessary to take vaccine. So I think past research has shown that vaccine preparedness, it would be helpful for us to conduct more research and identify key populations and along the line reasons for COVID-19 denialism, and then to identify mitigation strategies such as community engagement, who are the key messengers, and then for risk communication to counter that. As for communicating communication inequalities, we need to look at the reason people gave for the decline vaccination varied by the respondents' social demographic groups. So for example, during the H1N1 pandemic, African Americans were most likely were the most likely ethnic and racial group that to report not having tried to get the vaccine but not being able to access it. And also we study also showed that a halal vaccine acceptable to Muslims was the main factor that determined Malay Americans' decision to accept vaccination, whereas safety of the vaccine was the main factor that influenced vaccination decision-making for Chinese and Indian Americans. So therefore, ethnic-sensitive efforts are needed to maximize acceptance of vaccines in countries with diverse ethnic communities and religious practices. So finally, I will conclude with Asia. In Asia, COVID-19 denialism may not be such a critical issue. The questions we need to answer for are most likely vaccine safety, partially due to some problems in the past, like in mainland China in 2016 and 2018, there were some challenges with vaccine safety, and also the communication about rapid deployment of and development of vaccine. And most importantly, in places where COVID-19 is not really a threat, for example, no longer a threat, a major threat to like public health, to the communities, for example, in Taiwan and other places, I think the answer we need to address would be, do we really need a medical intervention for a threat that has already largely been like brought under control? Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks very much, Lisa. I think particularly your points on needing to address COVID denialism and the sensitivities to the cultural and ethnic diversity will be key point. And I'm going to quickly turn to in our Africa region, where I think some of those points will resonate. I'll turn to Yodi Alakija. Thanks.
Thank you, Heidi. Yes, it's been really fascinating listening to both Carissa and to Lisa from the two different regions of the world, because they do most certainly resonate. The issues around denialism and what the state of the pandemic is in Africa, I'm going to go into by looking at what exactly we've done. Regarding, you know, how COVID has evolved over the last few months. There are those, and I know Heidi, you and I have discussed this, there are those who had thought that the lessons from Ebola would really help with the response and the control of COVID in Africa. And unfortunately, that was not entirely the case. I mean, I think the first thing that one would say is that in one respect, there were lessons learned, and the Ebola experience helped us in that we now have certain institutions and structures and mechanisms in place, such as CEPI, which are helping towards the vaccine development side of things, as we heard Beata tell us quite eloquently earlier on. So yes, CEPI really is as a result of Ebola, so that is a great lesson learned, not just for Africa, but for the globe, you know, the entire world. In addition, I think within Africa, we had enhanced surveillance mechanisms in place. You know, we have temperature taken almost routinely now at airports. I know most certainly in Nigeria and in other countries, you know, your temperature is routinely taken as you arrive. And so border officials across Africa were at high alert from very much from the get-go of the when we were alerted sort of late February as to the nature of this pandemic. However, we're dealing with a very new virus, and these lessons have not necessarily served us so well. But Clarissa mentioned the sort of social, economic, and political factors that have most certainly played a part in South America. And I think it's interesting to listen to her, because as she talked about what's going on in Brazil and Mexico, there's so many parallels between Brazil, Mexico, and for instance, Nigeria. I mean, let me go a bit to numbers. I know that to date, South Africa is now being touted as the biggest problem in Africa, but is it really? South Africa has now 290 approximately 1,000 cases of COVID-19, and they're getting about 12,000 new infections daily. They have tested approximately 3 million people over the last few months, and they have a population total in country of 58 million. In Nigeria, which is my sort of other example, we have about 38,000 people compared to 290,000 positive, COVID positive diagnosed. And we're sort of seeing about 600 now daily, with 250,000 to date tested, less than 250,000 to date tested out of a population of 200 million. So there already begins sort of my sort of thesis into all of this, is that I feel like in Africa, we're sitting on a silent pandemic. There is very much, you know, that sense of denialism that Lisa spoke to earlier, but also that sense of exceptionalism, that because we had Ebola and we've dealt with it, and also because this pandemic was reversed in certain ways, you know, in the case of Ebola started in Africa, so there was a global, concerted, coordinated effort to help ensure that it pretty much stayed contained within the continent and didn't affect the rest of the world. So resources were brought in, and I mean, I know many of us on this call remember those days. People were flying into Africa, nations were setting up Ebola responses, the UN was setting up, you know, special representatives, so the Secretary General on Ebola were springing up in every agency to ensure that Ebola was contained. We haven't had the same thing with COVID, because of course it started in Asia and then it went to Europe and then it came to Africa. So in many ways, Africa has been left to sort of deal with it, but also has experienced the socioeconomic consequences. I would say that we've had an economic pandemic in Africa before we had the sort of health effects, and that is skewing the understanding somewhat of this virus. It's skewing the understanding of the pandemic. And there is a concern, I would say, that Africa gets left behind, not just in the vaccine side of things, but as we go to sort of the denialism and the sense of misinformation right now, because the whole world had, you know, we're seeing these huge numbers from initially from Europe and then from America and then in South America. And Africa is saying, and particularly countries like Nigeria are saying, well, we're not seeing that, because the disease also mimics. It's not dramatic. You know, I had a conversation earlier with a colleague, and I said that, you know, COVID is a subtle disease. It's very covert. It's a subtle enemy. And Africa is not a continent that does subtle very well. You know, we don't do subtlety. We're dramatic in our colors, our culture, our drums. So we don't get subtlety. Ebola was very dramatic in its manifestation. So there was an instant fear factor. And so now we have a situation with COVID where we don't understand the disease. So how on earth are we going to accept a vaccine? And I think for the vaccine sort of confidence building, the Convince project, which we're going to talk about, initiative, which we're going to talk about a little bit later, those are the key questions. Because if Africa is left behind, then, you know, nobody in the world is safe. And how do you convince entire group of people. I mean, let me take Nigeria as a case in point, 209 million at last count. How do you convince a nation of 209 million people that something that mimics to them malaria or a cold or typhoid or whatever else is being put around there at the moment? What, you know, heart attacks, we keep hearing all over Nigeria that people have slumped and died. And it's like, no, they didn't just slump and die. It's COVID, most likely. But the testing mechanisms are not in place, and there hasn't been the focus. There hasn't been the political will across many of the African nations to get that structure. So how do you convince people to accept a vaccine that, you know, like Lisa was saying, you know, it might be difficult in Asia because they think they've controlled it. While in Africa, it's not that it's been controlled, it's that we just don't believe it's there. The denialism and the misinformation coming out from the global north also has been a huge confounder in this instance, because so many still of those nations do look to leadership from the, you know, the other nations of the world. There is American CDC that is assisting in many of the African nations. I know certainly with the Nigeria response, you know, there has been an element of America CDC providing technical assistance. But America CDC themselves are confused at the moment. You know, one day they want to close schools and one day they don't. One day testing is important and the next day it isn't. So that is playing a huge factor. And we're seeing really an evolution of a virus in sort of as almost as an iceberg in many parts of Africa. There has been, and I would say almost historically, if you look at the Spanish flu sort of hit the Asia, it hit the Great Plague, most importantly, actually hit Asia, hit Northern Europe. It spread around the world, and it was in the second iteration that it really hit Africa. And whilst we're sort of sitting in this complacency at the moment, thinking that it isn't going to hit Africa, unfortunately, people are dying in huge numbers. But because, again, of the weakened health systems and the weak infrastructure, because of those socioeconomic inequalities that we're hearing about also in a place like Brazil, we're not counting the dead. We're not, you know, we don't have huge graveyards like you've seen in Brazil, unfortunately, in many rural areas where people can identify that, well, we have fresh mounds. We can't do retroactive mortality surveys so much because also resources are stretched. And that, I think, is the conundrum for Africa right now, because as we turn around and we say, okay, well, how are we going to convince people? And I'm using that word for a reason, and that acronym word and acronym, the pun, is most certainly intended. How are we going to convince people? It depends very much on us having the tools to educate the populations and to educate in local language about the disease itself, about the virus itself. And we need to achieve ourselves as a global health community and as a scientific community, we need to achieve fluency in the situation before we can communicate effectively the need to vaccinate against it. And, you know, this is a discussion, it's a seminar, but I think really it's also a brainstorming session for all of us who've been involved in this, you know, lead up to the vaccine initiative that we'll be talking about in the next session. But how do we achieve these things? You would be hard pressed to sort of name off the top of your head countries in Africa that have dealt with this. You talk about denialism. In the early days of the pandemic, we had Madagascar produce a cure in some herbal tincture, some juice, which not only did they produce and manage to convince, again, that word, many of the African countries that it was actually a thing. I know, for instance, and this is not anecdotal, I know that the president of Guinea-Bissau hand-delivered a consignment to the president of Nigeria of a juice that was supposed to be the cure-all to COVID-19. So we have a lot of work to do on that continent. We have a lot of work to do. Again, also, I'd be remiss if I left out my sort of greatest constituency, the most vulnerable people in Africa, not just in Nigeria. We have humanitarian crises all over Africa. We have Central African Republic. We have, you know, still Sudan and many other countries in a lot of trouble. How are we? We're not even testing in these populations, and it's not being mentioned globally. And so this is also a cry out that we need to advocate for those, you know, IDPs. I have anecdotal reports of IDP communities in northern Nigeria where there is COVID infection, or where people, but it's just accepted that people die. And so we're not measuring that. But with this disease and with this virus, until all of those people or a huge majority of them are vaccinated, not one of us in any ivory tower, be it in New York, be it in Washington, D.C., be it in Brazil or even in China, can truly say we're safe. Unless, of course, we shut down an entire continent, the Africa continent, and we refuse people entering the rest of the world, which, as we all know, is not possible. So I think I'll leave it there for now, having sort of, you know, I know we're going to have a little bit of a question and answer session, Heidi, but I think I'll leave it there for now, and having framed it and said that, you know, A, number one, yes, there are some lessons learned from Ebola, but very, very limited, you know, but I mean, a valuable lesson in terms of CEPI and a valuable outcome and an output. And so that is a global good. Number two, that denialism is a major, major factor in misinformation. And I would also hook on to what I believe Clarissa said about trust. There is huge mistrust of government within the Africa setting. I know certainly within Nigeria. So that also, you know, there's the belief that COVID has been manufactured by politicians so that they can make money. How are we going to convince them that the vaccine hasn't been, you know, again, put together so that there can be procurement exercises in place? Over to you, Heidi.
Thanks very much, Yodi. All key points, and there was definitely synergies across, but also I think it was clear that the different regions have quite different cultural perspectives, as well as political situations, socioeconomic, and histories, different disease histories. One of the other points that came up, this was from Yodi, about the difference between Ebola and COVID. It's a bit like the flu and other issues. I know historically in India, the bubonic plague had far more serious deaths than the 1918, or the Spanish flu in 1918 had far more deaths than the bubonic plague, although people were far more scared of that and far more concerned. And we see that as one of our challenges with flu vaccine, is people don't see the gravity, even though a couple years ago 80,000 people died of flu in a normal flu season. So I think one of our challenges with COVID will be, as Yodi said, and we'll talk more about this from here, more from Convince, that it's not just about literacy and fluency around the vaccine, but the disease itself and the characteristics. We do have a few questions. One is on the trust issue. I think this came just after Clarissa's intervention. There was a question about, is the trust about trust in science and scientists, or is it more about trust in authorities and politicians? Clarissa?
I think in a way they are compounded. So I don't think it's either or. I think it's both happening at the same time. So trust in a vaccine is usually supported by a web of different levels of trust. So you have the trust in government and science, but you also have the networks of trust that those individuals participate in, how they perceive the information, what are the sources of information that they trust. So I've seen stances when it's when there's a political turmoil at the forefront, which is, for example, what's happening in Brazil, that kind of takes the stage. But I don't think that one thing comes at the forefront and the other disappears completely. Yeah. And also, it's important to remember that how the public's view scientific information changes with what the politicians say. And the other thing also happens that sometimes when a politician is not following scientific advice, they lose a bit of the trust faith. So I'm gonna say it depends, but I would definitely not try to put them in silos. I don't think that's useful. I think it's more interesting to try to understand how this trust web is kind of interacting in different ways to support trust or mistrust.
Yeah, I think that very accurate. I mean, from my perspective, I think that's a good answer, and basically certainly relevant to our other experiences. Another question that came up is we had a couple of questions related to China and India. What are the confidence levels there, and certainly related to COVID vaccine acceptance. In one of the first slides I showed, and Scott will bring that slide up again, India and China were on that global polling of public confidence, or it's actually a specific question on willingness to take a COVID vaccine. And 72% of the population in China said they would take a vaccine. And in China, it was 87%. So quite high, but again, we'll see how the landscape goes. And given that both countries are huge, and we're working now more at getting subnational data, three deep dives in three Indian states and in different different areas in China to get more local specificity. And that's really where you see the diversity of opinion, more particularly with large countries, but we are working on subnational data on that. This is a question for Beata more. Is age weighing in the decisions on who gets the vaccine, given that we see basically an age bias and actually a bit of a gender bias?
Yeah, I guess it's going to be a question of supply and demand, and also the answers we get from immuno studies in populations that haven't yet been included in the initial immunogenicity study. So, you know, one would think that given the fact that the elderly and people with comorbidities are so vulnerable, and that the exposure of healthcare workers has been particularly high, you'd think, and these people are not necessarily of the same age group, that those would be prioritized if there wasn't vaccine for everyone. And children, as you also know, unlike in many other infectious diseases, are much less affected by COVID as a severe disease. On the other hand, their role in transmitting across society isn't yet fully established. So all of those things will influence the decisions. And then there's the question of pregnant women, for example. And you know, the data at the moment show that pregnant women don't seem to be too adversely affected by COVID, but we have many studies going on that are trying to get more data on this. So age, in a sense, and vulnerability will feed into the situation, and we need safety data across a number of scenarios. Don't know if that answers your question, really to the point, but I think age will matter, but also risk group profile will matter, I think.
Great. Thanks so much, Beata. We have three questions that are more Africa related. So I'll kind of end this shorter Q&A with Yodi. And then there's a lot more rolling in, but let's go with these. There's one on, I'll just read these off and you can pick them up, Yodi, as you go on. One is about the, can we empower, this is from Nigerians, can we empower countries in Africa to make their own vaccine? Would that help trust? I just will pitch in that I think it would, but, and there are discussions around that, but I'll leave to you to comment. But before I turn over to you, another question is, what is the role and how can institutions best support research on COVID vaccine misinformation that are locally embedded in Africa? I guess that's a more of a counterparts for local research on the COVID sentiments. Another question on, do you think anti-COVID vaccine narratives from you and US and Europe are influencing Africa? I think you already mentioned that was happening, but if you had something on that. And the last Africa-related question, and then I'll turn over to you, Yodi. Comment for Dr. Alakija, in addition to a sort of denial or doubt of existence of COVID, there's some other issues to consider. One, illness and death are not unusual for many communities and families. So unless the fatality is profoundly higher, it will be difficult to convince people about COVID. And is there a sort of distrust in government due to a feeling of disproportionate response to COVID versus other epidemics that are also fatal, like meningitis? Over to you, Jodi, and then I'll ask you to go straight in, since you've both participated in the CONVINCE initiative in this, if you could then turn over to Scott and Nancy. Thank you.
Thank you, Heidi. Wow, that's a big mixed bag. But I think the first few are really all very much linked. And thank you to everybody for those questions. I actually saw the one from Rhoda myself right at the beginning about empowering African scientists. And then we had the one about local researchers and sort of involving. I think all of it begins to speak to the what we say in humanitarian circles, being as local as possible. And as international as necessary. I think that really, that's the whole concept of the new way of working. And there's also a big conversation going on globally at the moment about the fact that there's a lot of, you know, research that is global north focused, that is focused in onto the global south. And perhaps in the case of a disease such as this, or a virus or a pandemic such as this, it's now been exacerbated because of the trust factor that we just heard talked about earlier on. I agree with the sentiments that we do need to empower, but it's not just about empowering. How do you empower African scientists to produce a vaccine? I mean, it's not something that you take into a laboratory and you just multiply. And it would take a much longer conversation and discussion going into the education system and going into STEM and, you know, science, technology and all of those deficiencies within many of our countries in education. We realize now what I think COVID has done is it has placed the magnifying lens on so many of our fault lines. It's placed the magnifying lens on our inequities within our system. So now we recognize that, yes, we want African researchers and local researchers to be involved in the solution, but if we're not teaching them at a very early age, if we don't have strong basis in education and strong basis in science and applied science as well, and also, I mean, not just pure science, but even the vocational skills that are needed in this sort of environment, we're not going to be able to be fully involved. I think that also comes into the narrative about the anti-COVID narrative from the US and Europe influencing Africa. Yes, I mentioned it earlier, but we've also had this before. I think some of us have to remember that, you know, polio has just recently, in the last 2 weeks or 3 weeks, has just recently been officially eradicated in Nigeria. But the reason it wasn't eradicated, and I know Heidi has done a lot of work on this in Kano, northern Nigeria, in the past. The reason it hadn't been done in the past was because of misinformation and because of superstition within our culture and within many of our societies, where it was believed that the vaccine was coming in to sterilize people. It was coming in, it was a tool. I mean, we're already hearing, and I know many of you listening have already heard that, well, the vaccination is going to contain, the vaccine will contain microchips that, it, you know, it's going to, I mean, some of the conspiracy theories are so wild, it's unbelievable. But I mean, I've had some high-level conversations with people who believe these things. So we need to be very, very, very cognizant of that fact that, yes, there is misinformation coming from outside, but there is also within our own countries and within our own continent. WhatsApp has become almost a tool in itself of mass destruction because of the misinformation that it spreads, as well as a positive thing. And lastly, I think there was a question about distrust. No, the question was about deaths and the fact that we're so inured. And I think I referenced it earlier on that, you know, unfortunately, yes, people die every day. I had to deal with a cholera epidemic about 3 years ago in the northeast of Nigeria. And I remember ringing a particular commissioner, health official for a certain state. And he said to me, Dr. Lakija, why are you disturbing me? People die. That's what happens. Poor people die every day. And we need to get over that. We need to value human life more. And it's not so much that do we need more people to die? No, I think we need a greater understanding even of the longer term effects. You know, so the COVID is not just a one and done. It's not just that you survive or you live, but we're now seeing that there's long-term sequelae. and that people who do survive are living with long-term health disabilities and consequences. We could go on forever, but I'm going to leave it there, and I'm going to move straight into the next session, because I know that both Scott and Nancy have other commitments. But we're going into a session about Convince now, which is a new initiative on the, basically it's a COVID new vaccine initiative. And as Heidi mentioned, I'd be very privileged to be a part of this. And I'd like, you know, one of the things I'm very proud about with this group is that from the get-go, you know, really from a few months ago, led by sort of Wilton Park, the London School, and Scott at CUNY, City University, New York, there's been a group that's come together, a group of us, a very diverse group of people that have been having discussions around what is this vaccine going to look like, even before we had candidates, vaccine candidates. So I'm very, very pleased to be introducing this next panel, as they're going to talk about preparedness for the new COVID-19 vaccine and the launch of Convince. Over to you, Nancy.
Thank you very much, Yodi, and it was fantastic to have had you on our dialogues to date, and you've been a fantastic background and setting for what we're going to talk about. So starting from the top from our speakers today, as we've heard from Beate, there are 218 vaccine candidates in the pipeline for COVID-19, but all of our investments will come to naught if these aren't taken up by wider populations. We've heard from all of the speakers about the impact of political and socio-economic conditions influencing trends, and that increasing trend around vaccine hesitancy. And we've heard concerns that have come up across the world, as this slide illustrates, more specifically around COVID vaccines when we don't even yet have them available to us. So what Scott and I are going to do as a double act is introduce you to an initiative we've been working on with Heidi, and more recently with others more broadly in the global health community, so Yodi, and I suspect others of you on this call, which we hope will go some way towards being prepared for COVID-19 vaccines and vaccine confidence issues, which are critical to whether vaccines will be taken up and ultimately have their desired impact of ending the pandemic. So we're going to give you a bit of a background for the reasons for initiating this initiative and bringing together a coalition, an outline of what we've heard to date from different sectors and the dialogues we've held so far, and how we're going to move forward with action in this space. So Wilton Park, along with LSHGM and CUNY, have initiated a call to action for a coalition we're calling, thanks to Scott's ingenuity, Convince. COVID-19, new vaccine information, communication and education. Convince's vision is to ensure that vaccines for COVID-19 we're investing in are optimised and are able to end and mitigate future outbreaks. So to achieve these aims, we must prepare a vaccine-literate public and persuade policymakers to A, trust the science, as has already been flagged today, and B, embrace new vaccines for COVID-19. So Convince is about taking a whole-of-society approach, recognising it can't just be the health sector that achieves this, to vaccine literacy. So it's about supporting multi-sectoral commitments to develop trust, preparation of accurate and convincing information sources about vaccines, and developing innovative multimedia and interpersonal approaches to communicate and engage with all audiences. And as we've heard from all of our other speakers, this is really about communicating with people on the ground and where we find them. So I'm going to turn to Scott now to tell you a bit more about the evidence base behind our vaccine confidence trends, and then explain a bit more what we mean by vaccine literacy and why it's so important and the bedrock of the Convince initiative. Over to you, Scott.
Great. Thanks, Nancy. And let me thank Heidi and everyone at the Vaccine Confidence Project for engaging with us on this and the time to both speak about this data slide. But also I'm gonna hold up Heidi's new book. This is not only a strong evidence base, but many strong ideas. And I'm going to take the liberty of quoting in the preface where Heidi says, there is no normal to inhibit our thinking. And we need to think today what the next normal might be. But even more, I think the other charge in stuck is how do we get unstuck? And that's what we've been trying to do with the Wilton Park dialogue and this construct of vaccine literacy. So one of the pieces that we wanted to add to the database, shall we say, is what is the current thinking of general population on interest in taking a vaccine? Heidi showed this slide earlier. We've used some multi methods to get at this, but the numbers are not promising, whether you want to call it herd immunity or community protection, that's a whole other issue. But we know that at least thus far, we think we need to be at least over 75% to have this in a population base. And as you can see, the numbers are quite low. I think these have been corroborated by not only the study that, that Heidi and others have done, but also we've been tracking this in New York City and seeing great disparities amongst different populations, whether they be African-Americans, Latinx, Asians. And a lot of this goes down to the bases we're analyzing of what's been highlighted in the webinar thus far of trust. So I will go to the next slide. And also notice that we not only have this poll supported by CUNY and others, but the U.S. Council for International Business supported some of the survey because they wanted to see how the government and business community might be working together on this. And not only do people think at different levels on the government side and business leaders, but the general population also does not seem to believe that the government and business community are working together. And we've used this as an exigence for more engagement with the private sector, and the U.S. Council for International Business has brought in others as part of the Wilton Park initiative, where we'll have a network with the International Chamber of Commerce, International Organization of Employers, business at the OECD, and Business Partners for Sustainable Development, linking with others in discussion as the World Economic Forum and others have been on our calls to see how we can leverage these communities and move these numbers up as they are on the left of this, principally in Asia. And the next slide was also to show that the employers have a role to play. You know, clearly in again, Asia on the far left, we've asked people if they would follow their employer's recommendation to get a vaccine. And as you can see, it's higher on some of the Asian countries. But nonetheless, as you go to the right, it does drop off. We do think, though, that this is really an upside. This is employers' recommendation. As we're talking about tracing and other areas, there's been an important role for employers, and this also has helped us. Let me also say, before we turn back to the convince piece, what we've come up with, and I think it speaks highly to, I thought, Beata's slide of the valley of death. We, in the clinical trials side, think of those two valleys, but the actual importance of vaccine or the vaccine uptake and immunization coverage. And if we have this third valley of death where people do not take the vaccine, all of this will be for naught. So our efforts have really been, how do we get unstuck? And not only Heidi's work, but the different words of vaccine willingness, vaccine reluctance, refusals, the hesitant, the questionables, the denials. We're trying to look at a way to help segment those different groups that might be within populations of country populations, as well as horizontal, as a way to, again, figure out new means to address the COVID vaccination piece, but also as we see drop off in childhood and other routine vaccinations. So what are sort of the three areas that I think have been key so far? That what vaccine literacy means is people need to have the information, not only about the vaccine itself, but as Nancy showed in the slide, on the denialism, and as Yodi said so well articulated, that people don't believe in some places that COVID exists or that this is a conspiracy and so forth. So there's a broad area that we need to start with that is to continue to build a base of vaccine literacy, understanding a COVID, understanding how a vaccine works, and also how it fits amongst society, say, with community immunity and other areas, and not get lost in scientific jargon with narratives and discussion points. The other piece of what vaccine literacy is not just information and education, which is the I and the E in our CONVINCE acronym, but also really good communication that embraces new technologies. Unfortunately, the anti-vax people have been much more successful. And if you, all the not only scientific papers in Nature and others that have been published of their 3-to-1 or higher ratio of anti-vax to pro-vax on the internet and other sources, but they've also created mass media with whether they're pandemic movies, isolated groups in the health insecurity world, gated communities, if we want to call it that, whether it's the WhatsApps, the Facebooks, and so forth. So we really need to figure a similar way, or even a better way, not only to counter that, but also to create pro-vax communities and the science and trust base that we need. And then the other area that we've obviously keyed in on, and which is highlighted both in our research, is multi-sectoral approaches. While there might be 12 to 40 UN agencies dealing with health and vaccines in one way or another, we also have public-private partnerships and new ones that we've heard about already, whether it's COVAX, how Gavi's been, CEPI, relatively new. We can go through a whole acronym of some of these others that are national and global. But we really need to figure out a way, which I think one of the someone named Michelle, when he had the first word on the Q&A, said, who is going to put together a communication plan? How are we going to have a global communication plan? And how will that work together? And that's one thing that we think Convince could do. And then what's a multi-sectoral plan? So some that will go via employers, some that will go via government, some that will go horizontally, and hopefully some that will develop organically with a good science and trustworthy base. And then the final piece on this, as we're working with all different health intermediaries, and Sabin has been engaged with Bruce Gellin and some of his team on our calls, how do we brand vaccine literacy as a backbone of the community protection? We all have thought about water, clean water, we thought about hand washing and other areas, but community protection also requires a vaccine literate and vaccine protected populace. And that we have to figure out in unique ways. Again, on Heidi saying, how do we get unstuck in the old ways? How do we create the new ways? And there's only one opportunity we really have when this vaccine gets launched, or vaccines plural. We need to talk about route of entry, whether it's injectable, oral, nasal, and so forth. All these things will be important on the vaccine literacy front. So I'm going to stop and turn it back to Nancy on what we hope to keep doing with Convince. But it's open to certainly the participants here today. You see we have a suggestion in the email, but I'll turn it back to Nancy. And then if there's any time for Q&A, I know we're getting close to the end. But I really wanted to demonstrate and thank Heidi and the team for engaging in such a meaningful way.
Thanks, Scott. I think in the interest of time, I'll just reiterate that what Convince is really about is to bringing together fresh ideas and different stakeholders. So really harnessing the power across all stakeholders, not just the health community, but bringing in creatives, bringing in different social scientists, bringing in the strategic communications, the intelligence sector. Where can we learn from people around how to address mis and disinformation? How can we learn about how to we best integrate and communicate to those that are hard to reach, in hard to reach and vulnerable parts of our populations and communities? So that is what Convince is about. It's that network. And I think going back to Beata's last slide of the individual circling out, our call is to, if you can, to getting involved, because everyone has a role to play, everyone in society, whether you're in big business or a community healthcare worker or on the ground or a mother, everyone has a role to play in this to ensure that we're all protected when and if there's a new COVID vaccines. So I will leave it at that, given that we've only got 5 minutes left, so there's time for questions. Turning back to you, Heidi.
Thanks, Nancy. I think we've one of the questions that has come up from a few, or topics I should say, that's come up from a few people even before Convince, and I think Scott already touched on it a bit, is how can we tackle the issue of social media networks and analysis. I think we did pick up on that a bit. You did also, Scott, already pick up on the question of the response on the global communication approach. But I think one of the things we've seen today is that while we need a global connectedness in approaches, we also need a lot of local nuance and local understanding. Platforms have become hugely diversified. There is no one place that all people go. I mean, you have your Weibos in some settings, you have different platforms. There are more and more platforms coming up. We are working with many because we can't assume any one platform is going to be where the action is. And I think that one of the things we're trying to do with the Vaccine Confidence Project, and it will be part and parcel of the collaboration with in Convince, is recognizing the social media and communication as a kind of ecosystem, and not to forget that people, radio is still popular, WhatsApp is popular, but people take photographs of a WhatsApp screen and, you know, read it on the radio, read it from the pulpit, or the imam reads it, photocopies it, tacks it on a tree. There are, you know, road trips, billboards. There's a bigger environment. And if there's one big thing we've learned in 10 years of our vaccine confidence research is to pull the lens back, keep a big picture. It changes over time, but keep the local nuance. We don't have a specific question about Convince, but I think we did end on the slide of, if you go to www.vaccineconfidence.org/convince, please send us any comments you have. We do have three more webinars coming up related to this topic. We will go carefully through all the other questions to help inform how we shape that. The next one is is the 30th, next week at 2 p.m. And that will be about trials, confidence around vaccine trials, both how COVID is affecting vaccine trials for non-COVID vaccines, as well as building confidence around some of the COVID vaccine trials, which are using new methodologies, human challenge, different approaches that are raising some questions. So we'll have specific issues. We will have a pause in August, but in September, we will have two more webinars. By then, we will have a lot more new data that we are collecting on a daily basis in our preparedness efforts for a COVID vaccine. We will, as I mentioned, go carefully through your questions to try to inform some of the topics, and we'll really thrilled all of you could join us today. Thanks again, and hope you can join us in one of the upcoming webinars, and do send us any thoughts, suggestions for Convince. Thanks very much.